My guests tonight are the Honourable Member of Parliament for the Yawaso West Wogon constituency, the Honourable Emmanuel Chiamanti Ejiakor. It's good to have you in the studio with us. He's actually my MP.
I'm happy to be here.
And also Ibrahim Amaleba, who's a member of the NDC legal team. Mr. Amaleba, it's good to have you back.
Thank you for having me.
You should move to our constituency soon.
Oh, I passed through your constituency to my house, so I'm quite conversant with his constituency.
Ah, right. Yes. Okay, anyway, so we are going to talk about the presidential debate, whether or not some political parties feel slighted. They've been talking about especially the PNC, and also there's some indication that maybe President Mahama may not take part in the debate. We are not too sure as yet, but the NDC will decide ultimately. We'll find out from Mr. Ejiakor if he thinks Nana Akufo-Addo should participate in this presidential debate. Also, the two of them would want to share their thoughts on the limited registration that ended on Sunday. And of course, there are some calls for an extension of the registration. Anyway, you're both welcome to the studio. Mr. Ejiakor, I'll start with you. I'll pick your thoughts on the limited registration exercise. How did it go in your constituency? I mean, it's important to add that you have the University of Ghana in your constituency, and we heard about all the challenges the students went through.
Very well. Thank you for having me, and let me use this opportunity to say a good evening to viewers. I think that the registration in my constituency suffered from what I believe was just poor planning. You know, I am just coming from a sister station in the same group, Star FM.
Right.
They're doing something on Legon campus, and I had to use the words, very harsh words, and told the gentleman that it was not personal. For me, after listening to the representative of the Electoral Commission, I think that the planning, it confirms to me that the planning was very poor. It was business as usual, not intending to be disrespectful at all, rather pedestrian. You know, it is like, okay, let us take a machine into every electoral area, and so be it. So nobody took cognizance of any other thing other than the fact that it is an electoral area. I want to believe that if you want to do something like this and do it properly, you must look at the local dynamics. Okay. You must look at where the population is. And make some decisions based not just on the fact that it is an electoral area, but that you need, after all, their mandate is to register Ghanaians who are 18 years and above and are the same and are ordinarily resident in that electoral area. That is the mandate. So you must plan and work at it. If you don't plan, You will just, and I think that is what happened, really. Every electoral area is the same. But I believe all of us will agree that if you want a place where there is an aggregation, a real aggregation of 18 years, freshly minted 18 years and above, it will be on the university and campuses. Let me use the word tertiary institutions. And to some extent, some of the secondary institutions. So my considered view is that the Electoral Commission should have looked a little bit more at situations like this. Look, in Legon, there are 23 polling stations. The voter population as of now is in excess of 20,000. This is as big as some constituencies. Mm-hmm. Okay. Brekum West, because the MP is my good friend. And I believe that he ended up having 19 electoral areas. Same figures. And I would say that when you take a place like Legon, there certainly is a big collection of of 18 years and above. The statistics are that, you see, in 2015, there was no registration. Mm-hmm. And so this is to cover 2 years. In the 2014-2015 academic year, the university took on some students in excess of 12,000. In 2015-2016, it did take about the same thing. Okay, there. And this includes what you call the distance and the city campus. Let us assume that half of this number came into what you call the regular student. Oh, they are domiciled on the Legon campus. You are saying that there should be about 12,000 eligible. Okay. I say this because most of the students, particularly the regular ones, come from SS into the university. Of course, I agree. There may be some mature students and all of this, but most of them. And all of us as parents know that most that come from SS into the university get in around the ages of 17 and 18. All right. Let us even discount this figure of 12,000 by half and say that there should be a possibility that you could register 6,000. I believe that the Electoral Commission should have factored all of this into their planning and then not make the mistake they made by just sending one machine. And it was meant to go on for only 5 days. Obviously, at the end, as soon as it started, all of us thought that there was a challenge. Look, in the first phase, they registered 447 in the 5 days. Along the line, we persisted. I personally went to the Electoral Commission and met the deputy chairman 4 or 5 times. Okay. It was later on, in the second round, in the second phase, that they decided initially to bring a new machine into Jubilee. This was on the second or third day of registration. So they did it for day 3, day 4, day 5. Then on day 4, they decided to bring in a third machine. Obviously, this is an admission that they had planned poorly. The figures are interesting. The second phase in Legon, they registered 637. The one that did only 3 days registered 315. And the one that did just 2 days registered 167. The second thing is that this was at a time the university was in revision week, just preparing to write exams. For me, what is most worrisome is that a lot of these young boys would wake up at 5 o'clock and come and join the queue and would not be registered and would be asked to come back the following day. I mean, if I'm a parent, I will not be happy about a situation like this. We are saying that because of the administrative lapses, there is reasonable cause to believe that a lot of Ghanaians who are 18 years and above, who are sane and are ordinarily resident in the electoral area, have been disenfranchised.
So you are for the extension?
If that is what will... I'm not a specialist in managing elections. But those that manage the elections must find a way to capture everybody that a lot of them.
If you listen to the director of elections at the EC, he seems to think that they met their target.
What is the target? Well, do they know how many students? If I asked him today, how many students are in Legon who are eligible to vote? Can he tell me? What is the target? I mean, In my constituency, in my home constituency, where I come from, the machine was in some places for 5 days. It registered 11 people. So probably, when you look at this, you would say that you met your target. But you set a figure. Let me use the word arbitrary, and you claim that you did 92.5 or 92.8% of that figure you set, what was the basis? What was the basis? I maintain that a proper thing to have done was to have gone to the to these places and asked, what do you have? If they had gone to the university administration and taken the statistics, they would have found out that they didn't meet their targets at all. Okay. Maybe they met their target and the Wawasi electoral area in my constituency, but certainly not in Legon, certainly not on the other university campuses.
Well, they said they had a national target of about 1 million.
I think it is very pedestrian to say, to lump everything together. It's a very easy way. I am just trying not to use the word lazy. It's a very easy way. It's a very, very easy yeah. way of doing this.
Before I go to Mr. Maliba, I just want to read a piece here from the Greater Accra Regional EC Director, who earlier granted an interview and said that in the Greater Accra Region alone, they had projected to register about 155,000, but they managed to register more than 162,000 within the 11-day exercise.
Within the 10-day exercise. Yeah. So, yeah, I mean, it is a projection. Mm.
So it doesn't necessarily mean that everybody... I get the point.
We talk about Ghana's population at the last census was 24. It's a projection.
Yeah.
Plus or minus a certain...
Okay, Mr. Maliba.
Yeah, let me say good evening to your viewers. As a son of the Upper East Region, I cannot but comment on the havoc caused by the rainfall, I think the rainstorm, mm-hmm. to the region. The most hit is the Bongo district, and I want to use this opportunity to, as it were, express my sympathies and empathize with the families who have been affected by this storm. I'm told that one person lost their life,
yes.
and my condolences to the bereaved family. And I hope that the NADMO in Accra will be listening to what the district chief is going to say and quickly rush to their aid. Having said that, let me say that generally, the limited registration was a success when you compare it to previous limited registration in terms of the fact that it was relatively peaceful, except in some few areas in the Ashanti region and some parts of the eastern region where we had some skirmishes. In the Ashanti region, we are all aware of the infamous slap of the member of parliament. And but when you look at it generally, it has been peaceful. I reckon that my colleague here is concerned about his constituency, and he's of the view that probably a number of people have been disenfranchised. But I'm also happy that in his own submission, he indicated that the EC made attempts to try to salvage the situation. So, for instance, he pointed out that some machines were sent in. That was an attempt by the EC to try to salvage the situation. But be that as it may, it's not possible that the EC could have everybody who wants to register come onto the register, because we are dealing with time, and we have been given 10 days for this exercise. The EC is going further to also implement some of its programs. You know, by the end of June, it will be undertaking this, what we call exhibition exercises. So the EC has a timetable and has a calendar. Much as I sympathize with those who could not register, I think that, again, these issues that he raised are issues that could have been raised before the exercise began. You notice that we all were aware, and I'm sure he's aware, that we were not going to use all the 26,000 polling stations in the country. We were going to collapse a number of polling stations and identify one suitable place for the registration center. And so if we knew about these facts that he's talking about, I'm sure he could have put that before the EC and ask the EC to do some engineering within his constituency. But I'm sure EC had rolled out these plans at IPAC. EC is not doing this all by itself. There's this IPAC, and I'm sure even in some constituencies or in some regions, they still have regional IPACs. I'm sure Greater Accra will have a regional IPAC. And so these concerns should have been brought on board, that when you look at the age group that is being targeted, that's the 18 years, most of them will be in school by that time. So why don't we concentrate so much in that area by providing more days to them or providing more equipment, machines to them? But to wait till this time and then to wait in the middle of the exercise for you to be raising these issues is also an issue for me to say that we have not also done our homework well. Much as we point an accusing finger at the EC, four also point at it. It's a collaborative effort. We should have known that, yes, 18 years will be found in the universities. And so what do? We should have raised these concerns, bring the EC's attention to it for them to be able to do these things properly. But generally, I think that the exercise went on well and that we witnessed this time round less violence as compared to the previous exercises that we had.
Okay.
Let me say that it is not that these issues were not raised. I am certain in my mind that these issues were raised. But even beyond it being raised, you see, it is not me. It is the EC must be apprised of all of these themselves. Otherwise, what is their mandate? Otherwise, really and truly, what is their mandate? It is not in midstream that anybody raised the issues. They were raised when they and the excuse they always gave was that they were short of budget. Okay. The excuse, even when the matter was staring in our faces and I had gone there, the excuse was that there was no budget to cater for any new polling station. But really, I mean, if you have a mandate and you don't know how, even within the constraints of a limited budget, to arrange what you have properly and do the needful, then I also have a challenge. Let me state unequivocally that these matters were raised. And I also expect that the EC should know about this. They have been running elections all this while. It's surprising to me that somebody will sit and think that unless it is pointed out to them, they wouldn't know. I think, you see, initially when it was happening, I thought that it was a situation peculiar to
your constituency,
to my constituency. Mm-hmm. But later on, I heard from the University Students Association of Ghana that it was a generalized situation. Indeed, at the KNUST, there was not a machine on campus at all. It was a machine outside campus, behind, I think, the Faculty of Architecture, College of Architecture or something. All right. How could this happen? And that one of the campuses of the University of Winneba, again, the same thing happened. There was no machine on the campus of Central University. If anybody says that anything and wants to exonerate the EC, I find it extremely difficult.
All right. We'll move on to our next topic, is the presidential debate. Mr. Maleba.
Yes.
Has the party been talking about it?
Yes. Today, our national organizer made some statements to that effect. But let me start by saying that the IEA should know by now that it is arrogating to itself some authority that it doesn't have, first and foremost. It should understand that it is a civil society organization and that it is not a creation of law in terms of a statute or constitution. And so if it has decided to take up the responsibility of organizing presidential debates, it is only to say that that is their contribution to our democratic processes. But they do not have the power and authority to impose on stakeholders, major stakeholders such as political parties, their calendar without first discussing it with the political parties. I think that is where this time they got it wrong. We are in an election year. The political parties also have their calendar. They would have drawn their calendar to suit them. Now you have an IEA, that is a civil society organization, whose activities are non-mandatory, whose activities are voluntary in terms of contribution to the democratic processes. Now, having not
consulted the major stakeholders and coming out with a timetable before even consulting, deciding that they will now consult the stakeholders. And when you listen across board, and even the MPP, that is even comfortable with the IEA's activities, this evening indicated that they are now...
Are they comfortable?
They are now... That is my submission.
I see.
They are now in a meeting to decipher what to do. The IEA has kept the MPP in that situation. Because if the IEA had consulted the MPP, I don't think the MPP would have been in a meeting this evening trying to even think about what they have done. So the approach is what most of the political parties are saying. But no political party is saying categorically that, no, we will not participate. What they are saying is that, look, you've put the cart before the horse. We are the major players. We are the stakeholders. You should have consulted us before. And you didn't do that. Now you've thrown our ideas in disarray. We don't know what to do. What our party is simply saying is that because they've not consulted us, we are not in a position to tell whether the times and the dates given are suitable to us. But our president and the president of this country has indicated clearly that, yes, he will want a debate, a one-on-one with Nana Akufo-Addo. I don't know whether that is what informed the IEA, but I'm hearing them saying that they undertook some survey and it was that they should have a one-on-one with the NDC party, MPP and NDC. Point is, the Constitution and the Political Parties Act says that Ghana is a multi-party democracy. It did not say that Ghana is a two-party state. Now, if you just take the MPP and Nana Akufo-Addo and for them the NDC and the president to debate, what are you doing to our democratic processes?
Well, they're not doing that alone. They said they are going to do the general one they have been doing for all the political parties with representation in parliament, and they are considering a separate one for the NDC and the NPP. They haven't made a decision as yet. It is a consideration. But definitely the one involving all the political parties with representation in parliament will happen. That is on their calendar.
So you notice that by considering a two-party debate in the form of Nana Akufo-Addo and the president, some political parties have taken issue with that. For instance, the PPP has called the IEA as an institution that is trying to erode the democratic gains that we have. I heard Paul Kosindum this evening.
Okay, but what did the president mean when he invited Nana Akufo-Addo alone to a debate then?
Yes, that could be left to the two parties to do that. But as an institution, you don't deepen and try to bring about this division within the political...
But as you said, it's a civil society organization. Exactly. So they are at liberty.
Good. So that's why I'm saying that they should see their efforts as contributing to the larger democratic process.
Right.
And so the way they go about it without consulting first, it could also lead to a situation where the political parties will listen but will not act accordingly. And that is where I think they got it wrong. I think that they have to reverse the situation. They have to go back to the drawing board, talk to the political party. They have two platforms. They have the General Secretary's platform, which is called the Caucus of General Secretaries. And then they have the chairman platform. I've forgotten what they call it. So why didn't they use these two platforms to at least articulate their views to the political parties and then have the political parties buy into the process? So if you listen to all the political parties, they have one issue or the other about the arrangement this time.
Okay. Mr. Ejiakou.
Well, thank you. First and foremost, let me say that I am not fully apprised of this issue. Mm-hmm. I have read about it, but I have not looked at it properly. Let me state that, you know, in any situation, you would always leave some people unhappy. The reality of our lives is that you, for any decision you make, any decision you take, some people will be unhappy with it. But it is gratifying to note that they didn't come to these conclusions lightly. According to the IEA, with regards to the
two gentlemen
between His Excellency the President and Nana Addo-Dankwa Akufo-Addo, it is based on some research they conducted. Okay, so I believe that there must be some basis. But before I go on, let me say that IEA has contributed immensely to the political process in this country. I don't think that we should do anything or say anything that attempts to take away their contribution. Look, a lot of the reforms that have happened in the electoral process has been led by them or facilitated by them, and we must all be grateful. I know for a fact that several times the NDC has said things about them, has expressed unhappiness about them, has even labeled them, okay, as belonging to the other side other than them. If we all remember, is it 2012, in the run-up to the 2012 elections, they were categoric that their presidential candidate, the late professor, may he rest in peace, was not going to take part in the debate. I don't even remember the circumstances, but this is not new. In 2000, when he was sitting vice president, and he needed, and he was sitting vice president, and he was a candidate, they decided that it was not his cup of tea. Okay, so I am not too surprised that at this hour, they are coming up with all sorts of things. Look.
But if they have not been approached yet, I mean, Kofi Adams told me that they have not been approached yet by the IEA. So just like Mr. Maliba
you
said.
You see, let's also face it. The issue of presidential debate has almost become a feature of our elections. It is not a surprise they are springing on anybody.
Right.
If I remember correctly, and I stand for correction, this must have started around 2000. I stand for correction. Okay. We have had elections in 2000, we have had elections in 2004, we have had elections in 2008, 2012, and now. At all these elections, there have been debates. Debates for presidential candidates. So it is not something novel. It is not something that has not been done before. It is not just pulling a rabbit out of a box. It is something that I want to believe the political parties must also anticipate, that there is something that will come. They probably did not consult them on the time. They will give a time, and then what stops all the political parties from deciding that this is a good time, this is not a good time, so let's compromise? Somebody must take the initiative, and I think that they are taking the initiative. They have done it over the period, and it is not new. If the timing is not right, we can negotiate it. But I don't want to believe that it is right that anybody would think that they are trying to determine anything and that it is an NGO and that it is not... everybody knows that what they do is not statutory. It is not provided by law. It is not provided for in the law. But all of us, when it suits us, have gone on that platform. If we remember very well, they said that Professor Tamils was not going to go, but when he passed, they found it expedient to bring the president then. Okay, so let's face it. I think that there should not be too much about what they want to do. On the issues, okay, as to the propriety of two or all, I am happy that there is a correction. They are saying that they will go ahead and do a debate for everybody. Mm-hmm. Okay. This is where I was emphasizing that, you know, you will not be you will not be always happy. But in real life, you must always have some cut-offs. You cannot, it is not possible for you to accommodate everybody and everything. I think that over the past, over time, they have established that they will have a debate for all the political parties that have representation in parliament. Obviously, when you do this, you will take out Papa Kwesi Ndom. Okay. Mm-hmm. And I think that he has a lot to offer this country. CPP has no representation. Do they? No. They do.
They do.
They do. Kumungu, yes. Yeah. So they will come in. Okay. But if you use a criteria like this and you take out Papa Kwesi Ndom, I mean, even though he doesn't belong to my party, I think he has some very bright ideas. And just by this, you take him out. But you must set a certain criteria. You cannot accommodate everybody. Okay. Otherwise, we will end up having everybody. Odike will be there. Ekwadonko will be there. And everybody will be there. I think that, for me...
You think there should be a cut-off?
There must be a cut-off. And when they have done that, obviously, I think that it will be interesting to have the two. The reality of the politics in this country is that we are almost becoming a two-party situation. That is the reality. I mean, look at the results since 92. Well, 92 was not a good time, but in 96, okay. 90%, 95% of the votes went to either the NDC or the NPP. In 2000, it was the same thing. Of course, I must admit that in one or two of the elections, the contribution of the minority part of the small parties decided on who won. Mm-hmm. I mean, and I think that in 2000, very clearly, in the second round, it was useful for the NPP to have had the other parties
backing,
supported. Mm. But essentially, the outcomes are that almost invariably 90-95%
it's between the two parties.
It's between the two parties. Okay. So it might be useful. It might be useful. I am happy that they will give the platform to everybody. But at the end of the day, that is the reality we live with.
Okay. Mr. Maliba.
You see, the IEA is not above criticisms. If the IEA is noted for conducting debates during election years, it does not mean that they can do things the way they want. That's the point I'm trying to put across. That,
no, but I that, said that they're above criticism.
That, no, you are saying that they are contributed and then... So, yeah. Yes, we know about that. But it doesn't mean that because they have contributed to our democratic processes, if they go wrong this time round, read all the dispatches. Yeah. All the political parties have one issue or the other with the current arrangement. So it tells you that there's unanimity.
I think there's probably a challenge with the timing.
No.
I believe that it is something that can be negotiated.
Can you let me? So, yes, would this negotiation have been necessary if the IEA had done the right thing by doing what? By calling all the political parties using their own platforms, the general secretary platform and the chairman platform, to communicate this to them. We are only telling them that do the right things, and next time round we will not find ourselves at where we are.
Look, okay, so Mr. Maliba, you are not in favor of the showdown between the two candidates because you seem to think that everybody should be given a platform to play it safe.
Me as a person, yes, as a lawyer, I know that the Constitution France upon. A two-party state. The Constitution talks about a multi-party state.
Okay.
And I'll fight against anything that is geared towards reducing this country into a two-party state. That's my conviction. I'm not speaking for the party, but from my philosophy.
Okay.
And that by just singling out the two of them, they could have their private...
In a separate debate.
Yes, I'm saying that. The two could have their private engagement to decide that, look, let's organize this between ourselves. But any institution, be it government
or a non-governmental organization that wants to further this agenda by reducing this state, this country into a two-party state, I will stand against
but
that
person. So if an individual does it, what difference will it make?
I'm saying that. Let the two political parties, they have chairmen, they have secretaries. Let them initiate the move and say that we want to have a debate, two of us.
Right.
That I can understand.
So it shouldn't come from an institution,
an individual trying to, I'll fight that individual. I'll say that individual is trying to reduce this country into the constitution France have done that. No, it's a philosophy. Let me tell you, I am out to kill mosquitoes. And so wherever I see mosquitoes, I'll kill them.
Are you killing mosquitoes?
I'm telling you something. I'm drawing
Did the general hear it?
So if I'm out to kill mosquitoes and I find mosquitoes in your house, I have to kill. Yeah. That's my philosophy.
Right.
So I feel that, and this is my personal conviction. Nobody should do anything to return this country into a two-party state. In any case, you talked
but
about...
But Mr. Maliba, so if the two political parties come together and decide to do this debate...
This is a voluntary...
Then they haven't... They haven't reduced...
They have not, because they themselves...
Oh, I mean, I can't understand
They have decided...
So, but why would they consult the other parties
to join
them?
No. I really and truly can't understand.
And they have decided, look, we live in a country where we are allowed to do things that are within the confines of the law. There's no law that says that two of us cannot meet. There's no law that says that I cannot meet somebody and discuss an important issue. What the two of them will be doing is having a meeting, and they say they want to debate each other. There's no law that says that that cannot be done. But I'm saying that if an institution of state or...
If an institution of state
or a group such as IEA decides that they want to bring only two political parties together, I will stand against them.
After another platform where everybody had participated.
Yes. What is the criteria?
So you don't think what Mr. Dapo said make any sense?
Which is what?
When he says that realistically, as we go into this election, with everybody participating, all the parties participating, really and truly,
the NDC and the NPP.
Who have the opportunity, the chance, and what have you, to win the election? It's either A or B.
Do you know that you are now playing God?
I'm not playing God.
Do you know who will win the 2016 election?
I'm not playing God.
Do you know who will win the 2016 election?
I don't qualify to play God.
So, don't use statistics in 2012 to want to transpose it into 2016.
It is called reality.
What is the basis for saying that? Wait, let me have my say.
You have been talking all this while. No,
brother,
I haven't.
Why? You've been talking until this time.
Okay, Mr. Maliba, make your point.
So you make a point.
And normally I've told people who come on this program, I'm not here to say the things that will please them. So if you think that I will say things that will please you, forget it. I speak my mind. So I think that for me, the IEA debate is good, particularly for the middle class and the upper class. But I am of the view that this time around, they put the cart before the horse. And that is why there's hue and cry from all the political parties. I'm sure because he didn't hear and have no idea about what happened, that's why he's saying that everything is okay for them. The first boycott of the IEA debate by a sitting president came from President Kufuor in 2004. We subjected our own president, President John Mahama, to a presidential debate.
How about Vice President Mills?
You don't choose what I should say. I'm saying the sitting president. I'm saying sitting president. I've not talked about sitting vice president.
Oh, Mamba, you are so funny.
I didn't say sitting. Am I carrying a monkey? Why is that funny? Am I carrying a monkey?
I'm interested, not funny.
I'm not talking about sitting vice president. I'm talking about sitting president. So I choose what I want to say.
Okay.
Right.
Now, we subjected our president, President John Mahama, to a presidential debate. So we are not the people who chicken out. This is a president. Who call?
Because there are some who think that you're afraid.
That's what I'm saying. That's what I'm addressing now. Mm. We have a president who called the media and say, look, ask me questions. It's never done in this country.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes, you don't know. At the Flagstaff House, you are not always abreast of events. What's happening? Do you know that there was a media encounter with the media?
There's been a media encounter at the castle before. Yes, I'm
saying that a media encounter where the president did not come to give a speech and questions asked out of that, he only came and said, ask me all questions. From archaeology to geology.
I don't see the major difference.
There's a choice.
Because other be the press at the castle, the journalists ask any questions.
No. Nanaba, I'm saying that. For the first time, and this is not the first time that we saw a president who did not come to read a prepared speech, but subjected himself to a barrage of questions.
And when somebody read a prepared speech, did he say that you cannot ask any questions?
Is it true or not?
It is true, but I want to tell you that when President Kofor did it as well at the castle, he did not say, ask me questions based on what I have read.
He did not say that you can't ask my submission.
So they're still asking.
I'm not getting the trust of my question, my submission. The trust of my submission is that
the president is not afraid.
He's not the one who chicken out.
Okay.
That's the point I want to make.
All right. On that note, let's take a break.
I'm not comparing the two other previous press conference. I'm saying that a president who comes to say that, ask me any other question, it's not a president who chicken out.
I am so surprised at the thrust of Mr. Malbo's argument.
You have never made an argument. You are always surprised at mine.
I
always make yours.
I don't see the fuss about some independent think tank deciding that beyond creating a platform for everybody, our own research indicates to us that people will want to see the president and the leader of the largest opposition go on a one-on-one debate. It's not wishful thinking. They are saying that it is premised on some research data they have. You see, by extension, if he thinks that this will be creating a two-party, then I think that the thrust of his argument must be, so then let everybody that has a party, GCPP, Kwadwonkor's party, Odike's party, or the party Odike left, and everybody, because they are political parties, then let everybody have a platform. But practically, it is not possible. So when you do this, are you limiting democracy? Are you cutting off people from their rights? Practically, to manage a situation like this, you will say that there is a certain cut-off. And really, I don't see how anybody is trying to force this country to become a two-party. Indeed, what the Constitution frowns on, and it is not just frown, it doesn't just frown on it. It is in black and white that nobody must attempt to make this country a one-party state. But the reality, based on all the election results we have had, and I want to rehash, that based on all the election results we have had since 96, clearly indicates that this is what is happening. I mean, really and truly, sometimes I just hope that some of the other parties will come up. Mm-hmm. Okay. So that the balance is not always with NPP or NDC, but we must begin to learn to form alliances and broaden the base of governance. Nothing wrong. Okay. But the reality we have now is that based on some research they are having, they think that beyond what they will do for everybody, they must have this. And I can't see how anybody would interpret this as somebody wanting to make a two-party state. I think that there's nothing like that. A two-party state still remains a multi-party state anyway.
Well, Mr. Amaleba.
Yes, I'm just reading what PPP is saying.
Okay.
And the caption is, IEA marginalizing small parties. And it is to the effect that the actions of institutions such as the Institute of Economic Affairs throw the spotlight on the two main political parties to the detriment of smaller political parties in the country.
You don't think they have done this, Amamba. Oh. that is going to be a platform for every political party. Beyond that.
And indeed, that's what their press statement said. It wasn't actually a press.
Nanaba.
They had the media in their offices.
Nanaba.
Yes, Mr. Maliba.
We are commenting on what the IEA says it will do, is about to do.
It is considering.
That even the consideration can be commented upon, else we should close.
Okay, so what do they,
else
what
we
are they
close?
Considering?
I'm saying that you call us here to comment on the IEA
yes.
statement, which
and
includes what they are considering, what they have not considered and they are about to do, what we are here to comment on those things.
Okay. But, so but Mr. Maliba, you don't
and
I'm not gagging you.
And the IPP, I say IPP, PPP is also concerned about it.
Okay.
What
but,
are they concerned
but,
about?
They
the
have
question.
Just said that by so doing, it will marginalize the smaller parties.
But,
what is wrong with that? Eh? Yes. They say they are considering it. Do we have to also...
But Mr. Maliba, before we go on, I'm sorry, I had to cut in rudely. Even if the IEA decides to drop the idea or the consideration of doing a debate between the NPP and the NDC, and they decide to go by the what they have been doing over the years for parties with
representation
in Parliament, PPP will still not participate in this presidential
debate.
And even
that, do you know even that... The current arrangement that we had in 2012 and beyond, do you know that even that has been criticized?
Well, you can't.
It has been criticized
everybody.
By smaller parties, by people like Bernard Mona, of
the
PNC. It has been criticized.
So you
and
think it should be open
if,
for everybody?
And now, if they are going to even narrow it further to two,
they are not narrowing it.
I'm saying that they are considering that. We are saying that
after a major one.
That's what we are saying, that they are considering that.
Okay, after a major one.
After a major one.
Right.
Or even before, whatever it is, they are considering that. Our contributions here, I know they are listening, the IEA people. They will take it into consideration and say, oh, the people don't want it. Don't you know that what we are doing?
The people don't want it or the NDC doesn't want it.
Oh, is it the NDC that criticizes it? A PPP? What I read, is it a PPP or NDC?
It is PPP.
Yes.
I'm sorry.
So,
yeah,
it,
I know.
And
but...
I said that this, for once, this criticism of IEA has been broad. It's not just
but
one political
don't
party.
Don't you think it's
not
don't.
Just
isn't
one
it,
political party?
Isn't it misplaced? Isn't it misplaced?
You have not. You are not abreast of the issues for this
who
matter.
Says?
You said it. You
said.
You prefixed your statement with that. So
but wait,
you said that.
Mr. Maliba,
listen to the commentary.
Right.
I know you are a news person. You
yes,
listen to
I know.
In
I'm listening to Bernard Mona.
In 2012, the parties that didn't have opportunity.
Not about 2012. I'm
oh,
saying
come
that.
On. In 2012,
I'm
the parties that didn't have opportunity to take part in the debate were unhappy. It will always remain like this.
So that's what we are saying.
You understand me? It will
even
look. Even the electoral commission, when they have opportunity to share out cars, sometimes there is a cut-off point. Even the electoral commission, but that is the reality.
You see?
Come on, let's not pretend.
You see that when you people beat each other, you turn yourself. When the people are finished, you slap yourself. One day, you also be in that minority. So if you are making laws, make laws to encompass everybody. So when you find yourself there, one day, you will not be at a disadvantage.
It happens everywhere.
A president entered the cells. He was imprisoned. He came back and said, if he had known that one day he would be there. are you getting me?
I understand you perfectly.
No, one day. What is comparison? I'm saying
this,
that make
right.
laws that will encompass everybody.
Oh, come on.
Make laws that will take in place, that will take into consideration a greater number of the people. People are complaining. PPP is complaining. Is that NDC?
No.
PSC complained this morning.
PSC
so what
cannot
are you talking
complain
about?
Because they have representation in Parliament.
You see your intolerance.
PNC,
they can't complain.
They are
can't
not complaining.
Who told you? They complained this morning.
About what?
About the arrangement. They say, call Bernard Mona.
Bernard Mona, I know. I listened to him. I listened to Bernard Mona and I quite really didn't understand because the IEA never said that it was boycotting its original schedule. They were going to go ahead, stick to their original plans, have every flag bearer of a political party with representation in Parliament on a platform, and then later probably pay attention to the survey.
What is wrong with it?
So if you call somebody...
Where is the difficulty?
If you call somebody and pose a question, what do you think about the IEA's consideration of having two political parties to debate? And that person says that I'm unhappy with that suggestion. Is that wrong?
Well, the question
is that wrong?
The question,
is that wrong?
Nobody is saying it is wrong. But don't situate it in a context that that is the only thing they are doing. Mama, this is what we are saying. Don't situate
those
it in a context that
unhappy.
Is the only
those
thing.
Who are unhappy.
People will
those
always
who are
remain
unhappy. Those
who are unhappy. You will be unhappy about something.
Those who are on. Those who are unhappy.
In reality, sometimes you are unhappy about something.
Those who are unhappy are simply saying that, IEA, don't let that idea come to fruition. That's what they are saying. And they have every right to say it.
Oh, absolutely.
So don't say
nobody
that. Don't say that. Somebody cannot say this. Somebody cannot say that. Benamora cannot say that. And I'm saying that you should be tolerant of minority views.
Oh, come on.
Because you never know. One day you'll be in the minority. That's what I'm telling you.
But already I'm minority. So what's your problem?
And even for you, all loss be lost. All of you are in the minority. You lost. All of you lost. So
what's the point right
the
now?
Point is that
I can't even understand him.
They are all in the minority.
I can't even understand him.
You are all in the minority. You are all in the minority.
Really and truly, I don't see why we should be wasting precious time on this.
You've lost.
I think
PSC has lost.
I think CPP
has lost. All of you have lost.
I think this is a very straightforward matter. The IEA has decided that beyond what we do every time, we are looking into the possibility of doing something else. And it is not out of wishful thinking. It is based on some research they have conducted. Now, but let me state again that in everything we do, people might be unhappy with some of the actions we take.
Yeah.
I can very clearly understand Papa Kwesi Indum must be unhappy because this arrangement just gets him out. I believe he has some very good ideas.
Mm-hmm.
He speaks well. He has some brilliant ideas. But by virtue of the fact that he has no representation in Parliament, he cannot come on this platform. If I were him, I would be unhappy. I would have hoped that there was another way. But that is what we have now. You see, me, I would have been a little unhappy. I was a little hesitant when I was not too sure that there was going to be a general platform. Let there be the general platform. But I'm saying that beyond that one, the reality that we have in this country is that we have these two parties almost neck to neck. That make the last time NDC had 50.3, NPP had 48. Between the two of them, you are talking about 98%.
Okay.
That is the reality we live with here. So I don't see. When you do this, I am sure that PNC will be unhappy. But in the same vein that they will be unhappy, PPP will be unhappy that they have representation on the general platform.
Right.
I think it is innovative. I think we should try it. That is what I think. It doesn't take away anybody's right to be unhappy.
So you see,
it doesn't take anybody's right. I think it is innovative. It is based on some research findings. We should try it.
Okay.
Maybe they will. Subsequently, they'll find a way to improve it.
So, you see, you've made your point. That is what you believe in. I've not asked that. What you are saying does not make sense to me because I don't share your views. Park Kwesi Indum has made a point. I want to stick to that, and I want to follow that trajectory.
Okay, go ahead.
And I have the right to stay on that
course. Go ahead.
You cannot say that.
Go ahead.
I have no right... to be on that point,
I have never said
and
that
my
I
views
have never said that. I
are not unacceptable.
The caveat that
if we come here, and all that you say, I say I concur. Will there be a debate? So
sometimes,
I have my independent mind on this matter. So allow me to champion my cause.
Go on. I'm about go on.
You talk about IEA research. Did they tell you that? Margin of error?
Oh, come on.
Did they tell us the margin of error?
Oh, so you are looking
come
for
on,
the
on.
Details.
No, I don't
well.
Want us to think that because IEA has come out with a research finding, we should take it hook, line, and sinker. I will question every step that somebody takes. That's my style. It doesn't mean you go, IEA has said it is this hook, line, and sinker. We should take it.
Well, I don't think that's what is happening.
What then is my mind if I cannot question... I cannot question certain things that people do. And I just come here and say, I agree. I'm asking you a simple question. Did they tell you the error of margin? Did they tell you the margin of error? Will tell you whether that research is credible or not. If you don't know,
I bet you'll be looking for the methodology. Okay.
And the methodology, all these things. And to see whether their findings encompasses the views of the Ghanaians, and that it is a credible one. You don't just say that because IEA has come out.
And if it turns out to be credible,
then I can agree with his line of argument, but it doesn't mean that I'll still accept it.
All right, then.
I never asked you to accept it.
You have always been here saying that you don't think why I'm towing that line.
My challenge with you is that you are creating the impression on this platform that there is only one way that they are saying. What we are saying, and I believe that the moderator is saying the same thing. No, Amaba. There is an option.
You don't even consider that one. That's what some people are saying.
Who said? Minority parties.
So since morning, you've
got the minority party.
Yeah, oh, they see on. Themselves as a bigger minority party.
Let's take some messages here. I've been lying. I've been laughing. In fact, there's a term that says, I love die. You know, Mr. Maliba said, referring to you. All right. There's one message here I found as well. Okay. Dear Don, I think that conversation between the two of you earlier is actually trending on Twitter. Everyone is talking about it. Amaliba, you are funny. Amaliba says, don't tell me that. Am I carrying a monkey? Of course, you're not carrying a monkey. All right. Mr. Amaliba has charged. Well, his name is Abraham, not Ibrahim. You keep saying Ibrahim Amaliba. He's Abraham Amaliba. All right. Kwame Kukrentumi says the NPP and NDC presidential debate is not necessary. It should be for all. And he goes on to do a dedication to his friend. Unfortunately, I can't read that one. Okay, I'll look for more. Prosper Sosu says, for this senior Amaliba is not getting it about the debate between the two parties. What happens if only the NDC and NPP have reps in parliament?
That criteria should not be used. That's what we are saying.
Oh, now,
give up equal opportunity to everybody.
That would be a bit rowdy, wouldn't
it? Yes, but that is the kind of democracy we have chosen. Multi-party democracy.
Yes, that's true.
So give people the opportunity.
The organizer of the debate has its own modalities as well.
That is also the reason why it is also voluntary. If you invite me, I can go or I won't go.
You see, in the countries that have proportional representation, if you don't get a certain amount...
And we are not practicing that here.
Oh, well, I am not saying that. But I am saying that practically, people find a way to do all of these things. You cannot. The best thing to do then was not even to have representation. Then let all the 24 million people go and stand and decide on what they want to do. Okay. Mm. To have people's representation is the second best thing.
Right. Okay. I'll just take some more messages and then we can wrap up on the show. But yes, a big thank you to all of you for tweeting tonight, for getting State of Affairs trending on social media tonight. More messages here. This is coming from Isaac Smalls saying that the IEA has no right to decide which political party should participate in a presidential debate. Ajua and Samoa says, I think the IEA has contributed immensely to the democracy of this country, and so I am all for the two parties debating each other after the general one. Well, Samson Ahiabe says that I think that Mr. Amaliba is not getting it right this time around. I think it's very fair for all of us to choose between Anado and President Mahama. Anyway, on that note, we have to say thank you very much for participating in the show tonight, for tweeting all over and for sending us messages as well. Greetings to you from Robert Coleman, Mr. Amaliba of Zoom Lion. Okay. He says hello to you. Right, so...
And not to me.
Mr. Coleman, you left out Mr. Amaliba, but yeah, I'm sure...
This is
discriminatory.
This is discriminatory.
That is what you were in favor. When we say there should be a level playing field, you see
what's
now.
What is the message?
When the producers call you, tell them that they've not given you enough notice. You are talking about procedure now.
Right.
And you sit here and say that.
Where did this come from? IEA has done well.
You are so
funny. But haven't they, though? Haven't they done
well? We are saying that they should have informed the political parties first before doing what they are doing. That's the issue.
Okay.
That's the issue. We are not saying that they've not done well.
All right. Thank you very much.
When they call him, the producers, he tells them that, oh, you should have called him much earlier. Is that not procedure?
All right. Thank you, Mr. Baliba, and thank you, the Honorable Emmanuel Chemantejako, MP for Ayawaso West. Wogon.